This is Anupama, and I have with me my colleague Dana Kruger, who leads the life sciences practice globally, healthcare practice globally for us. And we are in conversation with Andrew Fry, who leads Baxter for Asia Pac in the region. He has been with Baxter for a number of years, and prior to that, spent again a significant amount of time in Asia with DKSH, and he's come to Asia from the US. So with that, maybe we'll just step right into the conversation. Andy, for you, Asia Pac saw the virus first. And so love to hear a little bit from you on how did Baxter and your team in the region spring into action and take the organization through these last few months.
Yeah, thanks, Anupama. It's been a journey. It's hard to kind of think back now that it's been nearly 4 months or so since January when this first hit. In fact, I was traveling in China and India, you know, all throughout the month of January, and kind of didn't even realize that this was upon us. So I'm not really sure what happened or what I was exposed to at that time. But, you know, when it first hit us in China, or first hit all of us in China with COVID in Wuhan, you know, we all thought about this as a China issue. You know, we weren't really sure. And I think that's how the whole world saw it until it came to the respective region we were in. Maybe it was an Asia issue. And I remember on February 6th, I came back from Australia from one of our launch meetings, and on 6 o'clock, got a WhatsApp message from the Singapore government saying, hey, we are now escalating to code orange, and this means X, Y, and Z to the Singapore market. We didn't go through a complete lockdown at that time, but it all of a sudden, you know, woke me up that, hey, this is now out of China. And so as an organization, I think that was kind of one of the seminal moments where we started to think about how do we learn from China? We'd already been talking, but when you talk and someone else is doing it and you're not actually having to do it yourself yet, even as the leader, you're not as deeply immersed into the process. So immediately by that Saturday morning, we were talking to the Chinese team, working on a playbook, trying to think about the Singapore office communication. And I felt like that process repeated itself about 6 or 7 times in Asia as different countries were impacted. And so as an organization, what I felt was that we actually learned to really lean on and learn from each other in real time in an accelerated fashion. You know, a lot of times we go through projects, whether it's a launch or a business transformation, and it's more structured from a business standpoint. You see it coming. This kind of hit, not in almost real time, although it was delayed a couple of weeks, but building playbooks and working with teams and kind of building on that. Actually, it's been an interesting process because everyone's had to learn resilience together, share the mistakes we make, and then build from there. So that's been kind of my reflection over the last 4 months. I think it's kind of iterated as we went from reaction to coming back a little bit, and then how do we move forward? And I think those three phases or those three things that we're thinking about now have been kind of cycled through as we've digested and worked through the business impacts to us here in Asia.
And Andy, if you think about that journey personally as a leader of a very substantial business that's also at the epicenter in many ways, particularly your business around the ICU products, how has your personal leadership style or approach changed at all? Or what have you learned as a leader as you've gone through this journey?
I think some things, we're a pretty inclusive team. So listening and kind of problem solving as a group isn't something necessarily new to the leadership team. So I felt pretty comfortable in an uncertain environment. But the speed that we had to do it, and then the flexibility to look at the team players and say, who has alpha, who has the experience, or who has the idea, and not just count on the hierarchy that's traditionally, okay, the largest country knows best. Those were things that I kind of have reflected on and learned and said, take a pause here. So in one aspect, it's been a lot about, okay, let's make sure we have a regular cadence and act fast. And that means that we don't have every decision just right. But the rule is, let's come together, make sure that there's confidence and clarity for the team. And that's forced us to do that faster. Maybe it was closing offices for one. That was an internal issue. As you alluded to, in terms of our ICU impacted businesses with our blood purification or CRRT, a lot of folks talk about the ventilator effect and a lot of the demand that went there. And right after that came the question about renal failure. And one of the first things that doctors would try and do is ease the pressure on the kidneys and then also purify the blood to remove the cytokine storm. And that's where our CRT product really came into play. And that increased the demand, I would say, fivefold in a number of countries. And so the question as a team then was, not only how do you manage your internal processes, but how do we manage the external processes? How do we create the right kind of allocation process? And that allocation process quickly became a global allocation process. It was easy in the beginning for Asia to get product, but once we were facing the crisis in Italy, in France, in the UK, and then in the US, all of a sudden the allocation process had to be much more agile and structured in a way that you could look back on it and say, we made the good decisions here. We focused on the area of greatest need, and we were able to provide as much product as we could to those respective customers. And so as the team worked through that, I was actually really encouraged because the maturity of the leadership team was able to confidently and clearly talk to customers about this and not worry about, hey, am I getting my fair share or not? I mean, everyone wants as much supply as they can for each country, but in reality, we were quite transparent from the top in terms of that product flow. So I think that kind of approach, the speed approach was really important, the thinking around who really has the expertise and trust. And then lastly, I think as we've thought through even coming back to work, it's the structure and the framework by which you try and problem solve. And so again, trying to think back as to one size doesn't fit all, and we have different infection rates in different countries. And what if infections come back? Do we have a framework where which management can open offices, but with certain clear signals, move back and close back offices so that we ensure employee safety and the like? So I think those kind of things have been quite memorable in my mind as I've gone through this process.
And Andy, to that point, you mentioned a couple of very interesting things, right? One was that the hierarchy within the teams was no longer in play and you were looking at the team as a whole, and there were people who were rising and from just about any part of the organization. And the other piece was leaning and learning from each other. How has that sort of played out for you in terms of identifying who your leaders are within the organization? What does it mean to lead in a crisis kind of a situation? How has sort of that changed your outlook on the team, and what are you seeing out of that?
Yeah, I think, I mean, as you reflect on certain of your team members and you see them step up and not just react, but respond and create new opportunities or build trust with their organizations in different ways. And you can see that through engagement surveys or other things that are being done in real time or actual actions. That gives you, you know, a lot of confidence as a leader and in your leadership team, and really saying, okay, what can we do more together? Or let's really talk about sharing that with the broader group or giving that person visibility within the larger organization. One of the things that I was really proud about early on before this went worldwide was that playbook that I alluded to when we first got impacted in Singapore. The Southeast Asia team built that based on the learnings from China with some of the China leadership team. And then within maybe 10 days, we basically set up a global platform for all GMs and Baxter to come in, and we shared it, you know, live. And normally you expect those things to come top down, but because of that, those leaders being able to step up, you know, I could confidently talk to my peers and say, hey, this is an opportunity. And we got a lot of response on that. And really it was them leading it, not me per se, it was them. So it's, you know, exciting to give people that platform and watch them run.
Turning to the future, Andy, you know, a lot of these observations you're offering sound like durable changes, you know, from a leadership perspective, things like the speed, the expertise and the trust, the letting others lead, maybe outside of the typical hierarchical structure that we've all sort of been operating under in larger corporations. How many of these aspects do you think are going to be durable as we think about the leaders we need in our healthcare organizations in the future state?
I think it's super valuable what we're seeing right now. I mean, it's almost like a laboratory for leadership. You know, one thing I reflected on coming into this, Baxter had been going through a cultural transformation over the past couple of years and had made a lot of tough choices with restructuring and really trying to do the right thing to put the company on solid, both innovation footing as well as financial footing. but more importantly, cultural footing. And so we have four cultural levers: speed and simplicity, courage and collaboration. And those four kind of levers are commonplace in our vernacular. So when you think about speed and simplicity, that is, it sounds easy to do. Simplicity is very hard, by the way, but it really, you know, it's easy to articulate. So when I first joined Baxter, we didn't have that, but you know, it really came from the top, from Joe, and we really all started to what we call live the levers. And we coupled that with some of the planning, like a couple times over the past year, really looking at our business continuity plans. So you have that kind of a structured way, even though none of them had pandemic in them, none of them did. I won't be saying we did, but that at least gave everyone, okay, we had a framework. We know who the people are, we know how to act. And then we know this kind of, here's what we have to do and here's how we do that. And so that cultural foundation has been really important. So I think it's very durable. And part of the thing that we've tried to layer on top of that is, okay, you've got the culture. Now, how do you really activate that and simplify that? And that really kind of ties to digital transformation, virtual work. And so those two areas we've been working on about the last 18 months, but we've accelerated them since early March in a much bigger way, because the mindset was, this is the time. If there's any time, this is the time. Use this crisis as a real opportunity for change. And so we always say, from lemons to lemonade. And we're seeing some really exciting things come out of that. One of the leadership team initiatives we did in early April, I said, let's do a Kanban. Just everyone get on Microsoft Teams. And I created three columns in our team site. And what is it that you want to plan to do in April? What is it that you are in process and what's done? And I just said, everyone put a project in there. We'll look at it from a month from now. I'm not telling you exactly what it is, but it should be transforming you or your team. And then we kind of went through it really quickly in our early May leadership team and spent about 20 minutes, and people were able to talk about things that they had done for the region or for their country. So I think, you know, it can be a big structural transformation or it can be an individual transformation, but underscoring those cultural levers, I've been quite excited with the progress.
And so how do you sort of see the future post-COVID panning out for you in terms of some of the transformation work that you're doing? Is it bringing, from a go-to-market perspective, you mentioned technology, you mentioned about some of the initiatives that you're looking at. So how are you seeing them playing out, and what does post-COVID look like in your playbook?
One of the biggest platforms we have is home dialysis, and usually it's called peritoneal dialysis. And it's less than 15% of all patients get treated for a variety of reasons, whether it be economic or infrastructure. Primarily, those are the two drivers. And so what's really changed is that when you think about safer at home, you know, stay home, stay safe, it really changes the thought process there. So we've really looked at, how do we enable this new safer at home type of treatment to be more widely adopted? And the things that we've worked on in underscoring this are something called connected health, or ShareSource in the vernacular of Baxter. And ShareSource is basically a connected platform for patients to doctors. So before, it took a month in a handbook of what happened, how many times did I do dialysis, and then I bring it into the office if I was a patient. Now, every night or every morning, the doctor or the nurse can look at all of their patients and say, how did they do? Even applying now artificial intelligence to change or predict, you know, should a patient be therapy be changed or should they come into the office? So, you know, that platform was there and gaining a lot of momentum. We have about 10 million treatments across the world. But just like, you know, video conferencing, all of a sudden it becomes, oh, that makes so much more sense now. So we're looking at technology layered onto our products. And that means that we have to have people who can sell that technology better, explain it better. And that's not, I would say, a muscle in our selling, you know, repertoire that's universally occupied or universally owned in Baxter. So really, for our go-to-market strategy, we're really looking at, how do we sell smartly and digitally, you know, sell the technology, but also then how do we deploy the technology better? So a number of things in our R&D, you know, pipeline are looking at layering on connected in the hospital or at home. So from a people selling standpoint and from a tech development standpoint, I think that's really one of the areas. I think too is really about activities. Right now, the go-to-market, you know, message, we're benchmarking prior face-to-face discussions and saying, how is that transformed into virtual discussions? And what does that mean in terms of volumes and effectiveness? And do we need the same amount of people? Do we redeploy in terms of developing better digital content to empower a smaller group or a different group? Those are things that we're looking at right now. And I think as a leader, I don't have the answer to that. I think right now the unpredictable is the norm. But I can demand that we are really clear on that skills vision and then that go-to-market ambition. We know in which direction we're heading. So I'm certain by the end of this year, I'll have a different makeup sales efforts. I can't tell you exactly how much of that will be digital, but I know it'll be significantly more than what we've done in the past.
Thank you, Andy, for everything you and Baxter are doing for patients. Thank you for your vision into the future. And thank you so much for sharing your insights on leadership, both for yourself personally and things we should be thinking about for the future state. It's really been a pleasure to speak with you. So thank you.
Thank you, Dana. Thank you, Anupama. It's been a pleasure. Really enjoyed it.
Likewise. Thanks for your time.
Stay safe.